Hello and welcome to episode 7 of the Scumbag, where we are doing something that we usually don't do, which is we have a guest. We're here. It's me, Ed Zitron. It's Felix Biederman, but we've also got CJ Lemeris, who is also at Adult Black Male, which is one of my favourite Twitter handles to have to say to real people. Hi, everyone.
How's it going?
I got a bad case of diarrhea today, but it's not going to get in my way.
I heard that you were... Well, I read on the Twitter that you nearly vomited during your workout routine this morning. That sounded immensely arousing.
Yeah, I dry heaved.
Nice job. And that's just where the strength goes in. You're just getting rid of air for strength.
More or less, yeah. Yeah, I mean, I did have to stop, and I did dry heave, and I did shit for about 2 hours straight, but I'd be surprised if I don't come out of this stronger.
Well, you'll come out of it lighter.
True, and stronger.
And stronger, definitely stronger.
So, this is an appropriate subject, because I don't even know how I want to word this one. It's the... We've always founded the Scumbag on finding the kind of weird detritus of the internet, and Felix loves this, CJ loves this, and I've had to cram this. It is the weird, wonderful, and truly insane people of the internet who just make videos with this. We've talked a great deal about the people who have these kind of imagined eras of fame, but these people take it to this insane limit.
Yeah, I mean, there's definitely, it's all over the board, you know. You have like those really, really crazy ass people that are just completely schizo, and then you've got the guys that maybe are a little mentally ill, but they're just going on big rants on YouTube about like how fucking GameStop won't take their their microwaved PS1 game back for $20,
which is reasonable.
Yeah, it's a reasonable thing. You should definitely, and with the extension of YouTube's video times, I mean, why not rant about it for 30 minutes? I think it's worth it.
And I've been forced, willingly, but really didn't want to, but did, to look at specifically DemoniusX, Rich Piana, and Dan Quinn, and I tell you, this is like, I've never done heroin, but I imagine this is what, it's just like sticking adrenaline in your eyeballs, maybe? That's the closest drug metaphor I can give you for this, because they are terrifying. Maybe not Rich, but the other two absolutely are. So take it away, Felix. You describe them for our listenership.
All right, so the three men we are profiling today are Rich Piana, the noted bodybuilder and owner of 5% Nutrition, a supplement company that makes products such as Full as Fuck, All Day You May, Kill It, and 5150. Also, real food. DemoniusX, a morbidly obese gamer who, in the past, expressed misogynistic opinions about women, seeking to replace them with fleshlights, as well as racist opinions, but has since renounced racism after he got married. Third, most defining of them all, a man that me and CJ are obsessed with, that many others are too, former Notre Dame football player, boxer, drug dealer,
the angel Maitreya,
father, prophet Maitreya, who made Frank Stams a genetic bitch. Dan Quinn.
You'll hear these two describe them with such familiarity and such... There's an affection there, but also a knowledge. I just watched them for hours on end, and I came out of it feeling like I'd been shitting and vomiting for the entire time. It was just... Rich Piana, I think, is a good place to start because he's the most normal of them, which I think is weird to say for a person who looks like Rob Liefeld created him.
Talk about damning by faint praise.
Yeah.
You line up DemoniusX and Dan Quinn, and you're like, I guess Rich Piana is more adjusted than these men.
Yeah, I mean, he's not like crazy. He's not straight up crazy. I mean, maybe a little body dysmorphia, but there's not. I think it kind of goes in that order. You know, Dan Quinn is just off the fucking map crazy. I mean, that guy is probably arguably one of the most crazy people on the internet. And then DemoniusX, you know, he's pretty crazy, but he's aware of it. And then you got Rich. So Rich is, yeah, he's pretty normal. He's a normal guy. I mean, he wants to be gigantic for some reason. He eats so much food that, like, I feel like I'm going to barf just watching him. But he's pretty normal, comparatively.
Yeah, sort of. I mean, I love watching the one. There was one which I watched, which is the generic one where he's trying to sell his stuff. He's like, you know, you're gonna have to eat 10 meals a day. You're gonna get to like meal 7. You're gonna be like, how the fuck am I meant to eat this? And then you're gonna watch me on YouTube eating the meal. And like, I'd love to imagine someone being like, ah, I can't finish my meal. Ah, fuck it, Rich is doing it. I need three more steaks today, and he's doing it. He's like, every day? Jesus.
What Ed is referring to is Rich is Bigger by the Day series, one of the most infamous things he's done in recent. So for those who don't know, Rich does not compete in bodybuilding. There's no reason for him to do this. But a few months ago, he goes, guys, 2016 is coming up. We're going to bring Big back. Big is coming back in a big way. And by that, I mean, I am going to attempt to become 350 pounds for no reason. And so Rich posts the exact steroid cycle he does. That is so insane that other bodybuilders make videos essentially telling Rich, you're going to die if you do this. This is going to kill you. And Rich responds by, you know, in a few of his videos, it always starts with him in his kitchen at about 5 in the morning. And he goes, oh, yeah, I hear a lot of people talking about my cycle, talking about, oh, yeah, oh, you're going to die. And then he just rolls his eyes like that's ridiculous. Like, it's putting on 80 pounds of muscle over the course of about 3 months is a normal thing to do.
Yeah.
But anyway, Rich disappeared for about a month after he posted the cycle. And it led people to speculate that he was either in jail or that he was hospitalized. But when he came back, he comes out with these videos where he wakes up, he does his cardio. He usually drinks about 18 egg whites because he doesn't have time to cook them. Drinks his oatmeal while it's scalding hot and burns his mouth because he doesn't have time. Works out for about 3 hours, highly specified workouts, like things where he's just working on his forearms, and then goes and buys about like 3,000 calories of food with his wife.
And that's all he eats every day, 3,000 calories? Or is it, how many calories?
Oh, that's like per meal. Like his dinner will be like 3,000 calories.
I watched one video of him, and the great thing about him is there is a genuine sense, and this guy, this is a spoken medium, so I realize it's difficult. Really, he does look like Rob Liefeld drew him. He is just muscle on muscle on just muscle. The muscles are growing muscles and starting their own YouTube channels, and he is fucking giant. And there's this great video about his, and he does a Cribs video. And it's funny you mentioned, Felix, that all of them start in his kitchen, because the first thing he says is like, yo, this is the kitchen. This is where we make our meals. We do the meals here. You know I'm bullshitting you. We don't fucking cook. And it's just like, what? And he opens up his fridge. He's like, yeah, you know why I got Haagen-Dazs in here? It's because I ate all the fucking Ben and Jerry's. Okay. Thanks.
Oh, yeah. That is also one of Rich's things. He eats a pint of Ben and Jerry's every night before he goes to sleep. And
he has like a fridge, right? By his bed for him and his wife for Ben and Jerry's.
Yeah, he has, it's like a champagne bottle fridge for Ben and Jerry's. And whenever he brings it up every fucking chance he has to. And then he always says the same thing. He always goes, I'm not fucking telling you to do what I do. I'm just telling you what I do. Just fucking honest.
But there's something nice about him, though. He genuinely, I don't, like, after just mainlining this shit, it doesn't seem like he is saying you have to do it. He truly seems to believe, like, this is just what I do. I'm a person who consumes more calories than you do in a week in a day. So, hey, give it a go sometime. But don't give it a go. Really, it's a bad idea.
It's a horrible idea. It will enlarge your heart and your organs. And if you're listening to this, I don't think you can afford Rich's steroid cycle. I think barely anyone can. It's a lot of gear.
How much is it? Like, seriously.
It's got to be, like, approaching tens of thousands of dollars a month. Jesus. For all his steroids and GH. But there's some great moments in the Bigger by the Day series because it went on a really fucking long time, like over 100 videos called Bigger by the Day that are all over an hour long.
Oh God.
And it's just like Rich driving around babbling about food. But there are several great moments in there where after he breaks through 310 pounds, he'll be sitting by his pool or something and he'll go, all right, so people are asking me, how do you feel? Do you like being 300 motherfucking pounds? And honestly, no. Every moment is a living hell. But I'm doing this to prove a point.
Oh, my God.
And what is his point? What is, does he ever actually say what that point is? Or is it just kind of this, like, thing he's created for himself that, you know, this just this point that he has in his head that nobody really knows?
I don't really think he has one. I mean, there was one video where he goes, well, this is for all the people that said that I was too obsessed with being big before, because I was only eating two meals a day and I barely worked out and I barely did anything and I was this big. So I want to show them what happens when I actually try to get big. And it's like, I don't believe you at all. Because before this, you've made several videos about how you did whatever it took and, like, have been taking drugs since you were 15 to do this. So I don't think that's the point you're trying to prove. But whatever point he was going for, I'm sure he proved it.
Well, I think that this is where you need to bring in the description of Rich's catchphrase that, what is it, 5% of people do everything, give everything it takes?
Do whatever it takes, right?
Do whatever it takes, sorry.
Yes. And that, like, for Rich, doing whatever it takes always means something, like, insane. It, for instance, means taking insulin and riding a bike for 2 hours to the point where you nearly go in shock. But you got to do it. You got to burn that body fat. It means waking up in the middle of the night after sleeping for 3 hours and cooking a full meal. It means tens of thousands of dollars worth of drugs for growth every month. It means, eating, like, you know, Rich makes a big point of pride of his doctor coming to his house, and Rich, while turning purple, will face to the camera and be like, see, I'm fucking healthy.
And the doctor's just pleading with the camera, just like, help.
I think the doctor is like a Dr. Nick type character, if I had to guess.
He's just there to, like, fucking, just aid and abet this guy.
Yeah.
Well, I've been looking on this site as well, and he sells these meal plans, and they're actually not the most stupid thing I've seen. That's one thing I will say for this fellow. These aren't completely stupid meals, unless you're meant to eat, like, 21 meals in one day, which may very well be the case.
Yeah, I wouldn't advise for people to eat 21 meals in a day unless you are trying to prove a point.
It doesn't tell you what you do. It doesn't say, do you eat 3 of these a day, 1 of these a day, all of them?
Is the assumption that you maybe follow his routine by watching his videos, or...
I don't know how anyone has the time. But I think that that's the magic. Like, maybe you don't have... Maybe you're just not doing everything it takes by watching an hour and a half of, like, YouTubes of a guy yelling at you.
But it is, like, if you go to Rich's videos, once you get past, like, all the people making fun of him or the same on his Instagram, you get to people who are like, holy shit, Rich is the fucking man. Fuck the haters. And I totally agree. Rich rules. I love him. But then they're like, this motivated me to do whatever it takes. And then I don't agree with that because I don't know how it could motivate you, because Rich is constantly like bright red or purple and looks like he's on the verge of death. But as Rich says, it is what it is.
I really love that phrase as well, like, as just a general term of speech. And I had actually an argument with someone the other day. They tried to calm me down over a bad situation and said, you know, it is what it is. Yeah, a fucking court. That's what reality is. If it isn't what it is. Ah.
Oh, I thought I was in a mirage.
Yeah, I thought this was all, like, sent elsewhere again. Except it's all in the computer screen. Fuck, now that'd be brilliant. But it's, you know, I genuinely want to. We've talked about various people. I think, perhaps not like celebrity deathmatch, but more just like millionaire matchmaker or just getting them in the same room. I want to put like Anil Dash and Rich Piana in a room.
Oh, God.
Look, they're very different people.
And I want them to argue about... I want to, like, do 2.5 hours, like, pay Rich good money to, like, brush up on Prince. and also give him the explicit instructions to argue about Prince with a Neil Dash.
I want to hear Rich just talk about any topic.
Yeah, but not bodybuilding. Like, I want to hear him.
No, not bodybuilding.
I want him to be like, well, you know, I looked at the Bernie Sanders leaks, and I have a lot to say. Just like going just this weirdly erudite rant about the DNC working against Bernie Sanders and how he feels like this country is just the complete. He starts talking about the left and how, and you're like, wow, Rich, really? He's like, oh, sorry, I went into a fugue state there.
All right, so a lot of motherfucking people have been asking me this question about Hezbollah. Asking me, has it been bad for them to be in Syria? And basically, what it is yes, they've lost a few thousand troops. No, they are not weaker than ever. In fact, if you go back to motherfucking the mid-2000s, right after the war with Israel, they have, what is it, like three times the amount of troops? And holy shit, you talk about the motherfucking Katyushas? Way more of those fucking things. And basically, if they wanted to, and I'm not saying they would, a lot of people are saying that I think they're going to do this, and they get, so don't get it fucking twisted, they could retake Sheba Farms from Israel. Peace!
Oh my god, I want this to happen so badly. I really, like, Rich Piana basically does a podcast with you about Syria.
Yeah,
I feel like Felix has thought about this a lot, too.
I think this is Felix's life.
Well, me and Andrew just send each other voice memos of us pretending to be rich, talking about, like, gaming, that are all, like, 5 minutes long, just for our own enjoyment.
All right, I want to talk about the Assassin's Creed. A lot of people have been asking me this. I don't think we needed female characters in Assassin's Creed. I just don't. And I don't want to be called a fucking sexist. I just know the models take longer to do.
All right. So people asking me about genderqueer themes in Undertale.
Oh, God. He is definitely unhealthy on some level. But there is a genuine... There's... Other than his genuinely scary... Just everything. He genuinely seems nice. He seems to want people to get somewhere. Don't know where that is. Don't know what point he's proving. But he seems to care. He's not like DemoniusX, who we really should talk about because Jesus Christ, who genuinely seems angry. He seems angry that anyone's watching. Like, he's happy, but genuinely upset with them.
There's not much that DemoniusX isn't upset about. I think it'd actually be easier to find the things that he's not mad about at any given time.
He is the not maddest person of all time. I mean, like, he is... So, if you have... When you eventually are listening to this, you should definitely pause and watch. We will put them in the bottom part of the podcast. You will see these videos. This guy looks like Hodor, has never shaved, and I feel a little bit crappy talking about someone's weight derisively, but it's also a dude who has gone on at length talking about how he has, and I quote, I paraphrase, slam that pussy, I believe it was, when he was discussing why he has a fleshlight. So he's just this, like, the gooniest goon, the evident goon, being mad for so long. And he's like, he always starts with, like, okay, gonna make this a short one, and the thing's 20 fucking minutes long. And he's just rambling, and you don't know what's going on, and it just goes and goes. And it's like watching this man's, I would say, a descent into complete madness, but he seems like he's already been there for a while.
And he's kind of aware of it, you know? Like, he always talks about his depression and this and that, and... there's always like this weird sort of vague misogyny, or sometimes even extremely pointed misogyny. Yes. Sometimes he just comes right out and says it.
Surprise.
A lot of really weird, just vague hatred, you know, sort of permeates every single one of his videos. And it's like this omnidirectional rage. It can be at like his ex-girlfriend or his ex-girlfriend's bitch mom, or, you know, then he'll just immediately go back to talking about how he's drinking tequila from Mexico, which is the land of tequila, as he's tapping the bottle. He switches gears pretty fast, but he does seem genuinely unhappy all the time.
And it's amazing when he finally... Well, Felix, maybe you can open this one up a bit. What happened? Did he get divorced?
DemoniusX did not get divorced. When I look at the pathologies that, you know, these people... We'll get into Dan's pathologies later. But, okay, let's... Why is Rich the way he is? Well, Rich has a psychological need to be the best, or at least to be noticed. He doesn't want to be average. One of his most painful memories is his first bodybuilding show where he did not even place. So whatever it takes became his credo, and attracting attention in every way became a lifestyle for him. That's why he makes bombastic videos where he goes, steroids actually make your dick look bigger because they shrink your balls and your dick hangs lower than your balls. Demonius X is more the symptom of how loneliness can drive a man insane.
Yeah.
If you remember in the video, the first DemoniusX video people saw, Fleshlight, where he goes, all right, this is part one of my Woman Hate Blog series. And so he made this video in about what? Probably like 2006, 2007, 2008, something around there.
Yeah, I think it was 07.
When he goes, 07, yeah. When he's talking about the last time he had sex, and he goes, and listen, I'm going to be fucking open and honest. I don't care if it's too TMI or whatever. I don't give a fuck. All right. So I had the bitch on that bed over there. And I was reeling her snatch like there was no tomorrow. And I came in my condom. And it felt wonderful. September 2000. And you go, holy fuck. Because he talks about, like, sexual contact after that, where he goes, I had a friend who was a girl, and she let me touch her chest, and that was some good-ass shit. But reasonably, you can go, it's been at least 5 years since he's had any type of romantic gesture to another human being. And his weird tics and his frequent drunkenness is symptomatic of a man who has gone insane from being lonely.
And there's a weird quality to it as well. It's like this weird, like, I would love to find out if, like, Anheuser-Busch had, like, sponsored him, because the whole thing, like,
they paid handsomely for that product placement.
Yeah, he's like, what was it? It was like, yep, okay, drinking some Miller High Life. It's the champagne of beers. It's very delicious. Goes down smooth. It's a drinking beer. Yeah, I got a beard now. It's like, what? Curveball. What do you mean? You got a beard now? Okay. I thought we were talking about Miller High Life, man. Come on. Keep... I can't do this. I can't do this anymore, man. And he's just... And there's this... There is a genuine sadness to it that... And anyone else you see doing this, you'd be like, all right, I feel a bit bad for him. He's clearly got something wrong with him. And then he'll just say things. And you're just like, well, nope. No sorrow for this guy anymore. He'll be like, black people are wrong. Just out there. Just throwing that out there, fellas. It's like, oh my God, why?
Yeah, he's good at that. You know, you do really start to feel bad for him because he keeps getting fired from jobs. As far as I know, at least the videos I've watched of his, he lost one job waiting tables, which, or in a restaurant of some sort, which he recalled as being not pretty. And he let his manager, when they told him that they were letting him go, he really let her have it, in his words.
Yes.
And then I know he got fired from a phone company, which now that he was fired from, it describes as the shittiest cell phone company he's ever dealt with in his entire life. So you kind of, you know, you feel bad for him because it's like, this guy's got no friends, probably, definitely no romantic interests. And then, yeah, then he will say something insanely racist or talk about how, you know, women are just absolute, like, wastes of human life. And you're like, well...
But then he gets married. But then he gets married, and you never really get any details there. And but one of my favorite things he said was, oh, God, well, it was like, me and my wife bought some vape juice. It's so beautiful. It's like, I love makes me so happy. Like, that's, I can imagine him stepping back. And he goes on this, like, 10-minute long rant about the flavors of vape juice.
Yeah, he really mellowed out when he returned.
But then he got back to his old self, and now he started up a hilarious podcast that really is, I do not advise you listen to this, but I also advise you listen to this, because his insane podcast, and active one day ago. It just funny is one section where he's got other people's videos, such as funniest Allahu Akbar compilation.
By the way, I am also on this podcast. It's another one of the podcasts that I am on every week.
Yeah, you're up to what, 45 now?
45 now that I am on DemoniusX's podcast.
What, the Problematicist, it's called. And allow me to just read some of these titles. I'm going to just read what I can see on here. Social Justice Parasites and Hell on Earth, The Return of the Living Drunks, Two Crude Dudes. Then there is an hour and 46 minute long one, just 7.5, complete randomness. Next one, Fuck It.
Yeah, I want to hear
and
that
then
one.
The most recent one is Fuck A Bunch Of This. And what's great is it's him and this fella called Drunken Punk 800, which is my other screen name.
Oh, dude, I remember Drunken Punk.
Is he a notable
he's
one?
He's a character. He's a character in the Demonius world. The Demonius world does not have as many side characters or NPCs, as I like to call them, as Rich Piana and Dan Quinn world. But they do make up for it in their multifacetedness.
Well, it's just, the amazing thing is about these videos, and the reason I disagree that he's actually mellowed out, is because 2 months ago, Rage Vlog, Moochers and Hatred for Oklahoma. Insomnia Vlog 2, ugh. Vlog, Venting and Drinking. Short Vlog, and he is leaning back, and there's just him everywhere. It's just a lot of DemoniusX going on there. And it just says, today is my birthday. Which is the saddest fucking thing I've ever seen.
That's pretty fucking bad.
Okay. That's so... Here's today's my birthday, everyone. And the kicker to that, by the way, 455 views.
Oh, man. Okay, so the first DemoniusX video got a lot of traction all over the world. But here's... I'm going to talk about that video and why I think he's calmed down since that video. So my favorite part of the video, and a lot of other people's favorite part of the video, is when, after he gets tired of talking about, like, the 5 or more years since he's last had sex, he gets into race relations. And he goes, this is the best thing I've ever said in a video. He goes, and I'm not racist because I have black friends.
That's beautiful.
Michael Thomas is one. And the other one was Tyrone, what was his last name? Smithers. Yeah, he works at my work. And Tyrone Smithers is one of the most iconic things ever online. I love Tyrone Smithers. Everyone loves Tyrone Smithers. It's one of the best things anyone's ever said. But he was extremely racist. He was just dropping N-bombs right and left and everything. But his first return video back, he says basically what Hillary Clinton said when she ran for president in 2016 as opposed to 2008, where she goes, or DeMonius goes, the racism shit, I'm done with it. I'm still a misogynist, though.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I forgot about that one because I remember actually, like, borderline falling off my chair. Because, again, everything he does seems to have this weird, like, veering drunk driving element to it, where he'll be talking in a straight line. He's not like Dan Quinn, who is straight up just zigzagging. You can't keep up with him.
You can't nail him down.
But with DemoniusX, it's like he'll be like, yeah, so I'm not racist anymore, still a misogynist though, don't worry about it. It's like, oh, okay, great, so you've covered like most of it, just not all of it. I also like that he is applicable to Hillary Rodham Clinton. I think that's a great political thing. I expect that Medium post from you in the next week.
Yeah, like how Hillary is like DemoniusX in the best way.
I think that there's no beating him, but he's still great. He's just this very strange, and I think he's indicative on a wider scale of a lot of these, going back to when I used to be like 275 pounds, there's a nasty part of me that was kind of like, I could have seen myself in this guy's shoes. There are a lot of people back then who were like that. These very large dudes playing EverQuest. And as we progressed, I'd say there are less of them, I'm happy to say, because I feel like the whole thing that created this very large gamer man was actually a genuine degree of ostracizing anyone who played the vidges. And that's, and then again, I thought that for a while, and then Gamergate happened, and I was like, oh shit, they've just been hiding.
Oh yeah, I don't think it's decreased at all.
I thought it did though for years, come to think of it. I really did. I thought it got better. I thought World of Warcraft kind of opened it up, BlizzCon being a normal thing that semi-normal people go to. And then fucking Gamergate, man. I don't know. That shit's crazy. And they're a great example of crazy internet folk, like the one who's a magician. You ever see him?
I did not, no. I never caught that guy. I'll be honest with you, I'm only like halfway aware to this day what Gamergate is. I know it's something about harassing women and ethics in game journalism and video games.
I don't want to explain it because, frankly, it's very hard to explain.
Please don't. I've gone this far. I'd like to not know what it is.
All right, so in September 2000, the bitch turned psycho, and that's how it all got started.
Yep, and Zoe Quinn actually had sex with every journalist. Every single journalist, male and female.
And DemoniusX.
No, that's the thing. DemoniusX, she went to him and said, DemoniusX, as the last remaining figure who discusses gaming, I need to have sex with you to corrupt you so that I, the leader of the SJWs, can corrupt all gaming and then end man. I want to remove men from society. He said, no. I'm drinking a Miller High Life. It's the champagne and beers. Goes down real smooth. It's a drinking drink, you know, Zoe. And she left. She was like, fuck it, nope. And that's actually how Gamergate started. He was the last man. That was fucking D-Day.
Yeah, he was sort of like Rorschach in Watchmen.
Yeah.
I want to basically look down at the world and say, I'm not racist because I have black friends.
I was looking at the fleshlight and I just don't know how it works. Must investigate further.
But, like, so that's, I mean, it's easy to get him, yeah. I think. It's like you get it. He's, like, a resentful, misogynistic guy who ends up getting married to another YouTuber and, like, gets sadder but not as sad. And, you know, he's appreciable because of how weird his language choices are and the funny terms and ideas he has. But he exists in a linear world.
Yeah. Dan Quinn doesn't.
Our next guy does not. No. He doesn't.
Not at all.
So, first, I'm going to ask CJ to describe Dan Quinn to people. Because, see, I consider CJ the finest Dan Quinn scholar in the world.
Yep.
Dan Quinn is, he definitely has knocked it out of the park in terms of insanity. And I think that's partially because he's had an underlying mental illness and also played sports where you get a lot of concussions,
mm-hmm.
and also abused crystal meth for a long time. He's a ex Notre Dame football player who, in his eyes, got set up for getting, he got set up to get kicked out of Notre Dame because he defied Lou Holtz on the field. And in doing so,
Lucifer Lou,
AKA mini Hitler, Lou Holtz. He defied him on the field. He made the greatest play in Notre Dame history, according to him, and then got set up for an attempted rape, which he did not commit. And after his uncle let him burn, he became... It gets kind of murky after that. I think he got addicted to crystal meth at that point and moved in with his mom, and then somewhere along the line discovered stevia.
Oh, but he was an amateur boxer immediately after. That was before the crystal meth.
Yeah, you're right. That's it.
That's where he becomes an amateur boxer, and he meets Joey Womack and Mike Perino, and he beats Vaughn Bean, a fighter who went on to can for Michael Moore and Evander Holyfield. And he loses a close split decision to Vaughn. But Mike Womack and Joey Perino come up to Dan, and they go, Dan, you are blacker than Vaughn Bean.
And that stuck.
And that stuck because it meant that Dan was basically a black boy trapped in white skin, as he puts it.
Oh, God.
Because of how fast he is. You know, Dan has great testament to his speed. He's talked about running on a football field near a school and a bunch of school kids and a grandpa in a truck stopping to cheer for him because he was so fast.
That's right. That's right. His son's track coach, I think, said something about that and made mention of the fact that he was faster than any of the black boys he'd seen running on.
Yeah.
He brings that up a lot. He's got a really weird thing about like wanting to be black or like being part of the black group he always brings it up, and he always like the black guys are like the pinnacle of, you know, speed on the field and like football players, and he's like one of them. He was blacker than like any of the other white guys, and he always brings that up at uncomfortable lengths and describes it, you know, real weird.
I mean, yeah, one of my favorite Dan Quinn stories is when he's at Costco and he's waiting for rotisserie chickens and he sees a group of guys and he goes, referring to the play, by the way, the thing that got Lucifer Liu earned his ire, he goes, "Whoa, if you guys heard about an outside linebacker snagging a brother on 4th and inches, what color do you think he would be?"
Oh my God.
And the guys go, "I don't know, man, black." And Dan goes, "Nah, it was me. Gotcha." But anyway, so Mike Parrino and Joey Womack got Dan to go to Marquette, Michigan with them, where it's uncertain what happened because Dan like never went on to fight in boxing. That is probably where he got addicted to meth. But he also had run-ins with Mark Brannon, who he calls AKA Mel Gibson from Tequila Sunrise.
Yeah,
he was a highly successful drug dealer.
Yeah, he brings that up a lot too. He's got this weird. He brings up Mel Gibson and Tequila Sunrise and about how like Mark Brannon wanted to kill his uncle Fred Riva, who I'd say in the Dan Quinn world, there's probably two main nemeses that he's got a lot. Don't get me wrong. He's got like beef with all, you know, new person every day of the week.
Humans.
But yeah, the main two are of course Lucifer, Mini Hitler, Lou Holtz. And Fred Riva, which is his uncle, I believe, and according to Dan, handcuffed him to a tree for 4.5 hours when he was 8 years old.
Right.
And also set him up at Notre Dame and basically fucked his whole life up. So he's always got, like, keeping that in mind, he's always kind of got those two guys in his... I mean, even though his uncle's dead, that doesn't really stop him from making videos addressed to him and calling him out.
And I have to stop you there because you've missed out, both of you, because you're so deep in it. I need to take you out of that. So here's how these videos are delivered. Because Felix and CJ, they're doing a beautiful job of actually telling this in a contiguous and intelligible manner. When most of these videos are taken with like a grainy camera and this dude just screeching... Like someone you'd see in like a really bad neighborhood just yelling at you for killing him in a future life that he's imagined. He has the cadence and delivery of someone who, if you saw him near your house, you'd just lock every door and window and close the shades and just fucking hope.
Yeah,
he's like Mad Max. He's a Mad Max character.
His early videos especially were real high energy. I assume that because of, you know, him being like spun on stevia.
Oh yes, CJ, can you describe the discovery of stevia to people?
Oh God.
Okay, all right, yeah. Basically, he believes that he's discovered what is called cold fission, or sometimes he calls it cold fusion. The two are kind of interchangeable. And essentially what he does is he puts stevia and water in a blender and he blends it, and it makes it magically, the water expands magically,
yeah,
multiple times over, and the foam that rises to the top is all the man-made toxic shit that he alleges the government, or there's like the nebulous powers that be, put in the water in order to make us fat, give us cancer, things of that nature. And so by blending it, he not only, one, filters all the toxic shit out into this white bubbly soup, as he calls it.
Yes.
But then also it somehow creates a form of energy, which he calls cold fusion, that can power cars. It can power spaceships. It would replace gas. It would end the war in Iraq.
What
and
the...
it's like, so I guess it's like nature's miracle is what he sees it as.
Yeah. There's also that one beautiful video just that everyone needs to watch. If you're going to watch any of these videos, and trust me, they are deeply so, because the one thing we're saying is like they're funny and all, but they're also deeply like kind of sad and painful.
Except for Rich.
Apart from Rich. Yeah. Rich is fine. But like the Dan Quinn ones, I found myself genuinely exhausted.
He's hard that to keep is, up with. Yeah. I mean, he goes all... He switches topics. I mean, in a five-minute video, I watched him go from threatening the Mormon church, calling out someone named Craig Tuescher, calling out the MMA guy Dana White, talking about jail cell fights, talking about how he doesn't live in the past. And then, how he doesn't live in the past, he doesn't talk about football at all anymore. And right. then how hackers have compromised his cell phone because when he puts his cell phone in his pocket, the ringer turns off, so he believes he's being hacked. And then he talks for like another 2 minutes about football. So he's really hard. And I mean, in all of these topics, he can go from addressing some woman that he's interested in on the internet to talking about how he's going to beat someone to death in a jail yard fight back to her. And then like talking about stevia.
So this all sounds reasonable.
I mean, it's nothing if not interesting, but it's very, especially if you're not well versed in all the weird characters that Dan Quinn has in his universe, and all the other just kind of weird concepts and things that he believes. It's a lot to take in. Most people turn it off after about a video.
All right, so there is something I really want CJ to get into, but before that, I feel like we have to introduce some characters. So me and CJ are going to talk about our favorite characters in the Dan Quinn universe. I will kick off with three of my favorites. We've already talked about Mark Brandon and Lucifer Liu and Fred Riva. But in the latter chapters, like I guess you would call this more like the Book of Romans or Corinthians in Dan mythology, I would like to talk about the Vagos.
Oh, the
Vagos are a motorcycle gang that Dan is associated with.
Of course.
And you have Vago, like full Vagos, like Crazy Joe, who Dan had an altercation with, known as Crazy Joe's Folly, and who let Dan stay with him and acted like a bitch when Dan bought him chicken from Der Wiener Schnitzel. You have Dave Aroni, who I consider a Vagos adjacent man, who is a like 5'2" guy who doesn't form coherent words and is too cracked out on meth. And like the only time we see him in a video, they're outside Abnormal Tattoos, a tattoo shop, and Dan goes, "Yo, this is fucking Dave Aroni. He's about to say some fucking genius shit." And Dave Aroni just starts squirming in front of the camera and goes, "A lot of dead cops."
Yeah, you can't understand a word he says the entire time. And he talks in, yeah, that crazy, like, "Well, I guess I..." And, like, you can't understand any of it.
He's Boomhauer.
He can't hold his hand still at all. Like, you could put a gun to his head and tell him to hold his hand still, and he can't do it because he's so cracked out. And Dan's calling him General Petraeus and something about... he calls him General Petraeus a bunch of times and how he could, like, lead the war in Iraq or wouldn't go to war in Iraq. I mean... Dave Aroni is definitely one of the best characters in the Dan Quinn world.
I'm going to be honest, sounds like Han Solo and Chewbacca.
yeah, Dave Aroni, like, I've never seen Dan respect anybody on camera as much as Dave Aroni. Like, he says that Dave Aroni is the white Edward James Olmos in American Me. Which is, like, that's another Dan obsession.
That's so specific.
Taking movie characters and inverting them racially.
Yeah, he does, or just inverting race in general. He loves, yeah. He really has a weird thing about that. Harry Gopal's another one who was also in that video.
Oh, yeah, Harry Gopal's in there, aka Harry the Pitbull Gopal, aka Paul Gopal. It's really, his actual name is Harry Gopal. It's unclear why he was Paul Gopal for so long.
I am so confused. Like, I feel like, you know, like I've stepped into some alternate universe, or like, you know, when something's going on in comic books and you haven't read for like 5 years, and you open them up and there's all these new characters and half of them are dead. And one of them's like Iron Man is a very, very large Asian woman now. I don't know. I assume that's what Iron Man is. Like, that's how I feel hearing these stories.
I'm going to quickly explain Harry Goatball. So Dan in CJ, it was like 2009, right, when he fought Bon Lapua?
It was 2009 when he got spun on stevia and broke Bon Lapua's collarbone. You are correct.
Yeah. So Dan had an MMA fight, like, after making all these videos about how he was going to beat up Kimbo Slice and all this shit. And people were like, dude, Dan's going to get his ass kicked. Any fighter would beat him up. So he fights Bon Lapua, the Samoan wrecking ball. And Dan gets punched a lot, and then Bon Lapua gets tired, and Dan punches him a lot, and Bon Lapua quits. And Dan wins. Dan wins by stoppage. He knocks him, he gets a technical knockout. Dan next fights Harry Paul, the Pitbull Gopal, who is younger than Dan, actually black, not like inverted race black, like, you know, black boy in white skin, etc. He beats Dan. Dan says he only lost because the arena was colder than he thought. I mean, Dan's only weakness really is cold, which is ironic because he does cold fission. But, you know, it is what it is. But he becomes friends with Harry Goatball and later claims that Harry Goatball has given him permission to say the N-word. Harry Goatball repeatedly tells him on Facebook that he has not given him permission.
Is that how it works? To say the N-word. Is that how it works, by the way? Do you actually have to go and ask your local African American for permission? Is it like a...
Yeah, you got to hit up Tyrone Smithers in your life and ask. Okay, him, like, okay. Hey, can I say the N-word? I mean, you can never say it with the R. So he says it with the A. You know, it's never. I mean, because then it's just you're a racist.
Yeah, you're just racist if you do that. But if you get permission from Harry Goatball.
We need to eventually explain, because again, not on here, we don't know who Tyrone... We need to explain Tyrone Smithers. Is that just a friend of DemoniusX, or just someone he found?
He made them up. That's not a real name. There's no fucking way, right?
There is no way that's a real name.
I thought it was... I for a horrible moment, though the timelines never matched up, I was hoping it was someone who was in Hamilton, and we'd get a DemoniusX Hamilton video... So I was sitting here, I learned how to make a Manhattan, and you know, I'm Aaron Burr, sir.
Pardon me, are you Tyrone Smithers, sir? Why, yes, I am. I'm DemoniusX's black friend.
I'm Hamilton.
I can say the N-word because of Harry Goatball.
But that's my trigger.
Ed, rethink this.
No. That was the end of the rap. That's the clever thing. You don't say the thing that everyone's going to... You know nothing about rap.
Ed, do better. Rethink this.
I said trigger. I did not say that word.
Not a good look.
Yeah, come on, Ed.
Great. Now I need to go and get a permit.
I'll contact Goatball.
I'll get Tyrone on the phone.
The reason that I wanted to intro those characters is because CJ actually, he has crossed streams. He's entered a different reality. I don't even want to intro it that much. I just want CJ to talk about it. CJ, tell the world what you told me.
Yeah, I mean, okay, so Dan lives in Sacramento, which is where I live, which I think has always made this whole thing a little bit more, like, real for me. You know, I mean, I'd still be watching Dan Quinn videos for the better part of a decade, even if he lived in, like, Minnesota. But knowing that he's, like, in my town is pretty cool. So anyways, I've encountered him two times. I've run into Dan Quinn two times before. The first time was in just by chance. I happened to be in a grocery store in Midtown Sacramento, and... I saw him in the beer and cheese aisle, and I was like, which sounds stupid because he's a crazy guy on YouTube, but I was like starstruck. Like I couldn't believe I'd seen him. And he was had nothing. He was walking around with a handcart, had nothing in it, no items in it, and he was just kind of sauntering around in the aisle, like pointing at bottles of beer and like handling the cheese and like just kind of looking around. He looked like somebody was like he was waiting for somebody to kind of like sneak up on him. Like he kind of had this weird lingering paranoia thing going on. And then he just kind of left, didn't buy anything, walked out of the store. But the second time I saw him, and this is by far the more memorable one, was at a Vagos Clubhouse stevia party that he organized. He'd been hyping this up for a while on YouTube. And I think the original plan was to get all the Vagos from coast to coast to do this at their respective Vagos clubhouses. and that would somehow get, and everybody would be like getting drunk and doing stevia, and that would get stevia famous, which in turn would get him famous, and he could save the world with cold fission. I know, and I believe that narrowly beat out his other plan, which was to rent out a NASCAR track, and the Vagos would get spun on stevia and weed and drive around it for 36 hours straight, and that would like break a world record. I don't know what record that is, like maybe the record for like longest time driving in a circle by active gang members. I don't know.
Largest mistake.
But so he'd been talking about this for a while, and he gives out the address, and I have to go. Like, I have to at least see it. And it's in like, when you say the Vagos clubhouse, it's not really like a clubhouse. It's in a scary ass part of like South Sac, in a warehouse district, with a bar like inexplicably stuck in the middle of it for some reason.
So they can drink?
Yeah. I mean, it's one of those bars where you like, you don't even have to go in it. You drive by it and you're like, well, somebody definitely got killed in that bar.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, that's
for
sure.
It's obvious. So I park my car, like I'm heading up there trying to figure out where it is. And there's no street lights because it's a warehouse district in a shitty part of town. Why the fuck would they have any? I get up there, I finally figure out where it is, and it's just like a metal warehouse. There's about 50 people outside, and they're all drinking and fighting and puking. Most of them are like, don't have all their teeth, or they're like, I don't even know if they're necessary. They're trying to speak English, but you can't understand any of it. It's basically like what most people think of when they think of like a biker gang party. It was exactly that.
Sounds awesome.
Yeah, I mean, it's awesome, like, how if you rode a roller coaster with, like, no harness on is awesome. Like, it's, you know, you could die.
You didn't die, so it was funny. Die.
Yeah, it was funny. And so I'm looking around for Dan because I'm not going inside. They got the warehouse doors open. There's, like, scantily clad women. There's dudes, like, scary-looking biker dudes. And I'm like this, like, tall, skinny white guy who's wearing like a button-up fucking shirt. Like, I look like I do not belong there. And I don't want to stay that long either, because every 5 minutes there's like a cop rolling by super slow. He has his window down, just staring at people, like waiting for the first person to shoot someone. And so I'm like, all right, I'm going to hang out here for a while. I'll see if Dan shows up, like what's going on. And I spot Dave Aroni. And Dave Aroni is way shorter in person than he is on his videos, like way shorter. But everything else about him is the same. Like, he's just as crazy. You can't understand him. And he just runs his stunt. Like, he's like shaped like a really exaggerated bowling pin. Like, he's got this like narrow head and this giant fucking body. And he's just running his hands all over it, like speaking complete gibberish. And then Dan comes out. And if you've watched any Dan Quinn videos, you know that more often than not, he's shirtless, and which he was. And he's wearing like gym shorts and a fanny pack. And he comes out and starts talking to Dave Aroni about, I didn't get close enough to actually hear what they were saying, but he's got his fanny pack on and his bottle of stevia falls out.
Oh, no.
And yeah, and that's all it takes. I mean, all you really need to do is just make mention of the fact that you're down with stevia or you like it. Like, cause I've talked to him plenty of times on the phone and shit. Like, you know, that's a normal thing you do. You call YouTube crazy people and talk to him.
Yeah.
But,
I've also talked to Dan on the phone.
The cool thing about Dan is you could text him at like 4 a.m. and he would text you like immediately back. Like that. He always had his phone on him.
That sounds terrifying.
No, dude, it's great. Like, aren't you sick of people who don't text back?
Yeah, I am. And you know what? I kind of want to text him now. I don't know what about. Maybe he'll play Destiny with me.
I'll tell you what he'll talk to you about. he will talk to you about stevia and weed and the violin, which we'll get into the violin.
Violin's a big thing, yeah. We will talk about the violin.
But anyways, back to what I was talking about. Yeah, the stevia bottle falls out of his pocket, and he goes fucking nuts. He picks it up and starts waving it around, and he's yelling about stevia and weed, and Dave Aroni's like cackling. And finally, I'm like, all right, I got to go up to him. I got to at least say hi to him. So I go up and introduce myself, and he's always super sketched out when he meets new people, no matter who you are. I mean, he could, like, kill me easily. He's, like, my height and, like, twice my size, and he knows how to fight. But he's still super sketched out. He's like, who are you? You know, and I tell him, I'm CJ. I'm a big fan. I'm down with Stevia. And as soon as you tell him you're down with Stevia, he's just like, he switches gears. He's like, oh, what's up? Like, and he just talked to me nonstop about, like, getting spun on Stevia. Like, Stevia, he's like, you ever try Stevia and weed together? And, like, no, for the record, no, I haven't. But, of course, I tell him, yeah, because I don't want to, like, make him upset. And then he offers to, he's like, oh, you want to go in the clubhouse and we can blow some lines of Stevia and, you know, hang out. And at that point, I'm like, I look in the clubhouse and it's just, like, scary ass dudes everywhere. So I politely decline and, like, just go home for the night. I'm pretty sure that that probably got broken up by cops shortly after I left. So, yeah, that was a pretty big moment in my life. I mean, that's sad to say. One of the most surreal things I think I've ever seen.
And it's very Lynchian. It's like the movie Mulholland Drive.
He's got, I think the two main things I took away from meeting Dan is, one, he's really friendly. Like, you watch his videos and you're like, this guy, like, is always talking about beating somebody up or his weird, like, prison, if I was gay, like, homosexual things he gets into with his adversaries. But then you meet him and he's like, he's really nice.
He starts crying in one video. That's all I...
He cries a lot.
Don't we all?
Yeah, that's true. I just usually try to avoid doing it on camera. And the second thing is he's got a big fucking, like a huge head. And I mean, you can look at his videos and tell. I mean, he's got like a comically big jawline. But in person, it's like two of my heads. Like, it's like somebody took like a huge like block of stone and like carved a head out of it and stuck it on this guy. It's unbelievable.
That's incredible. I apologize to our listeners, or, well, they'll probably be quite happy that I've been quite quiet, because imagine just taking this all in one day, because both Felix and CJ have been so engrossed in this for a while, and they both mentioned it to me. And I'll be honest, I just watched it, and I was just sitting there texting both of them, just being like, what's going on? Why is this happening? Why are you...
Yeah, you seem pretty... You seemed pretty shaken up.
Well, I mean, I just... It was like a... What was it? Like a Thursday or a Friday? I think I did both. I just sat there being like, oh, Christ almighty, what... Jesus. Oh, no, please stop. Oh, you poor man. Stop. Please don't do this. Don't do... Oh, Yep, you've done it. You're crying about Muhammad Ali being dead. which is probably one of the more sensible things.
No, that was before Muhammad Ali died, because he made that video in like 2009.
Yeah,
For what Ed, when Ed was talking, because he's talking about how he beat up Kimbo Slice, and then of course because he's Dan, he starts talking about race relations, and he starts out by going, you know that shit they said about 40 acres and a mule, Muhammad, they lied like they always do. But check this out. Hey, wait, you know what, Muhammad, I could never show you disrespect. Because if I were to die and I could choose who I could be reincarnated as, it would be you, man. Oh, for sure, man. Yeah, his voice cracked. And then he's like, for any of you motherfuckers who might talk shit on me because I show some emotion, know this. Yeah, he started there. He immediately gets back to how he would make Kimbo his girlfriend and have sex with him in jail and beat him in a fight. But yeah, no, that was... He just got really, like, he was overcome by how much he loves Muhammad Ali, so... I don't know. Like, I didn't. He reacted less to Ali's death than I thought he would.
Yeah, really, he really didn't. I mean, the last time I saw him cry, I think, was when he was just mad at Joe Rogan.
He was so mad that he cried.
Yeah, that's usually what it is. He typically gets himself so worked up at like Joe Rogan or about being reincarnated as Muhammad Ali or any number of things. He's like, he's just so full of like tensile emotion that he just kind of, you know, starts crying. And it's like not really sad tears. I want to say it's like angry tears almost, but
yeah, I feel like I feel like, you know, how can I put this nicely, he just seems like nutty. Like, he just seems genuinely like his emotions go. And that video where he's driving and he's just yelling obscenities at his mother.
A classic
Dan Quinn moment, where he's just fucking gouging her. And he's like, yeah, you molested me, you did this. And she's like, no, what? Like, have you taken your medication? Like, oh, gee. Like, and you can, like, you can hear this, like, worry in her voice. Like, is this guy going to just swerve this fucking car into a ravine?
Yeah, well, that's the bet. Ed is talking about Sunday Drive with Mom, an iconic Dan video. Because early in the video, he goes, oh, I'm crazy. If I was crazy, bitch, I would crash this fucking car. And the video ends with Dan rear-ending the car.
He file the fucking papers, bitch.
Yeah.
That video's probably like one of the most, you know, classic Dan Quinn videos. And where he calls his probation, I really like the part where he calls his probation officer.
Yeah.
And then
he
tells him, you know, that he has been taking his lithium. And that he, and then he just, of course, being Dan Quinn, he immediately just goes into his childhood memories of getting handcuffed to a tree for 4.5 hours.
Sure.
And this is all a voicemail. He's not actually talking to him. He's leaving him a voicemail. And so he's telling him all this stuff, and then at the end he asks if it's possible to posthumously arrest somebody for handcuffing a minor to a tree for 4.5 hours.
And that is the first thing I texted Felix. I was just like, just quoting that and saying, well, is it? Good point, Dan.
Well, yeah, that's the thing is, like, so this is Ed's first time watching any of these guys. And with, you pretty much get the reactions you expect. Like, with Rich, Ed is texting me. He's like, Rich is so fucking big. This is insane. And with DemoniusX, he's like, holy shit, this guy's sad. And with Dan, he's just like, why is he like this? Like, what's going on?
Explained.
What's the plot? Yeah, someone explain this to me. And I'm like, Ed, you just have to watch all of them. You have to watch all, like, probably, what, like 2,000 videos at this point?
I watched 10, and I know less now that I've watched them. I've actually, like, there's, like, knowledge I had, like, of when people in my family have birthdays that is now gone.
Now you're like, yo, Oprah Winfrey, if you validate Stevia... Well, do you think, Ed, do you think, like, as a PR guy, you could validate Stevia?
Probably, but also, I actually think that a good way to wrap this into, if you can call it the real world of the internet, is these people are crazy through delivery. You can say one thing about all of them. If you put any of them with the kind of professional setup you have with Gary Chundigan or any number of these startup fucks or any number of these like YouTube stars, or any number of them, they'd probably have a very large following. They'd have people who were like, yeah, I agree. I agree. Yeah, Stevia, yeah. And Rich, I feel like he's the only one with any kind of production. And he's still... he's not fucking... None of them are totally fucking stupid. But Rich is smart. And that's the thing I'll say. That guy fucking knows what he's doing. He has found a way to convince... probably quite a lot of very small men that they can be very big men, and he has done beautiful videos to that effect. But the rest of them, if you gave them that platform, they'd be the same as any number of fucking people. I mean, my shit of the week proves that there is just as much complete dog shit from so-called smart people, if you'll allow me to deliver it.
What is your shit of the week?
Okay, I'm going to read this title out, and I'm going to stop myself from just fucking punching something. By Lee Alexander, who was a games journalist. I think she does games still. She's someone who has written a lot of things, and she was drunk on the Giant Bombcast once. That's my entire knowledge. Oh, actually, she goes out with someone I know who I went to school with. That's also a thing. That's all I know. I have neither good nor bad feelings, except bad ones, because... I used emoji spellcasting to prevent a hangover, is the title of this Motherboard article.
Motherboard has some really good articles.
Yeah, especially this one, and the lead is a killer. The word, quote, sigil, refers to an inscribed word or emblem that holds magical significance or power. And that's, I find, generally, when you're writing something, when you're getting someone into a really bizarre kind of, like, niche industry, you want to start with the most boring fucking plodding prose as possible. So, in medieval times, a sigil was an emblem that you could draw along with other ritual components. Fucking hell! If you can get past that first paragraph, you've already done magic. But basically, the crux of this article was that there are people who have claimed to create emoji spells. Use a moon and a sparkle in this emoji spell with a hyperlink to soothe insomnia. This arrangement of natural flora and fauna can be cast to protect the bee population. And this is someone, she was fucking paid for this. And there is not a slice of derision or criticism. And she, there's one bit where she goes, I also posted the same spell on my Facebook as a status, asking any friends who were willing to like and therefore charge the spell. Real person's words.
Well, I mean, isn't that kind of how, I mean, one like equals, what is it, one share equals one prayer, one like equals one prayer? I mean,
yeah,
I don't see why it wouldn't work. You could charge a spell doing that.
Yeah, similar equation.
Yeah, yeah. I think the conversion rate's about the same.
And it's brilliant. It's brilliant because... So the kicker of this beautiful article is... So I tried, let's call it a Hail Mary. I set as my alarm text an emoji spell starring a bright sun, the okay hand sign, the back on and top signs, respectively, and added the face of an angel who would never, never drink dark spirits the night before an important early meeting. She posts the spell. It worked. I woke with the air of a person who has definitely dodged a bullet, free of a headache and well-tired, even possessed of a certain calm preparation about the day's affairs. That is a fuck. Wow. This is someone, like, and I know people who are really good writers, writing about important shit, who can't get work, and fucking Motherboard is posting, quite literally, someone basically saying, I got hammered and I did emojis and somehow didn't have a hangover. Really? Like, that's it. This is what makes me mad online. This is what gets me.
Look, I mean, the personal essay industry is just kind of shit. But, like, they ran out of all their ideas in about 2014. Like, when they read, like, they ran, like, the 500th piece that was about, like, overcoming adversity or diversity or anything, really. And now it's just like, it's like a parody of Vice articles. It's just like, oh yeah, I did something that is weird to do. Yeah, here it goes. So it's the most, so I wrote a thing you could publish.
And I said I didn't have problems with Lee, and I should probably be honest, I have with a few things she's written. Not about Gamergate, putting that aside, just the general obtuse pontificating and useless prose, and this is it. Because usually with these Vice articles, there's usually like a wink and a nod to what they're doing. There's usually a degree of, alright, I know this is a bit fucking stupid. I know this is kind of weird, but let's have a go. Go on, shall we? And that's what I always saw Vice as, that when they did shit like this, like the Vice is Cool Twitter account that makes fun of them, was making fun of that. They were kind of saying, alright, we get it, it's stupid. This is written with complete seriousness. This is written like one of those pop-up ads you get on weird websites, where it's like, what, the special berry cured my third testicle. Like, and it's written with complete seriousness. I'm angry at it for that. And also that it got published and someone was paid for it, while people in journalism are getting fired. Like, IB Times fires half their fucking staff, or all of them. And yet, don't worry, you can write about fucking emoji spell casting. So yeah, I'm just mad in general.
I mean, it sits at a very interesting intersection of alcoholism and witchcraft and, you know, the perceived insipidness of texting. So I don't know, I mean, somebody's got to do it, right? Like, how else?
It did need to be written. I agree.
Yeah, I mean, if I couldn't, I'm not a good enough writer to write something like that. I think maybe she does deserve to get paid. Maybe you are a little too mad about it, Ed. I don't know.
Really? Yeah. Yep. Well, you know what, I'm mad all the time, so nothing changed. So now I'm definitely not mad. I'm not crying either. So, Felix, did you grab one this week? Did you find...
I do. Well, I, you know, my literal shit of the week is, like,
the actual shits you did?
I've been shitting all day. It's not a good look for me today. I think I have some type of stomach bug. I've had diarrhea all day. And I know a lot of you haters, like... A lot of you people are going to talk shit on me and say, like, oh, you had diarrhea? Did you mean you're, like, 48 podcasts you do a week? No, I don't. I mean actual diarrhea. But anyway, my shit of the week is this week, so it was the Republican National Convention. And that isn't the shit. It was people's react, like liberals' reaction to it, which was just the most annoying shit I've ever seen in my life. And it made me, didn't even make me want to like give money to Trump. It made me want to like give money to like something even more extreme than that. Like if I could donate to the Michigan militia or something.
You want to donate to the Bundys? Like,
yeah, if I could donate to like the Timothy McVeigh Innocent Party after what I saw this week, where it was just people like, this is not America. Is this really happening? Is this 2016 is a dumpster fire? And it was just like the most annoying shit ever. It's, you wouldn't know that the world ever experienced like two world wars, a fucking Holocaust, that this country was founded on a genocide, that segregation existed under official government sanction until 1963. Because according to like just the biggest pussies on earth, 2016 is the worst year in human memory because Dangerous Donald is at it again. And I just like, I cannot fucking take it. It's just the worst in liberal pearl clutching and the worst in just try to garner sympathy by displaying how weak you are and how everything makes you faint. It's just the most annoying fucking thing on earth.
And it's
most grating.
And it's annoying because it's annoying to talk about because you especially can't say, okay, you need to focus on this issue or this issue, because there's this whole thing, and my favorite Twitter account, Zenny Jardin, of course, said to fucking
the best.
And it's great as well because without fail, I think she was trying to discuss black people being shot by police all the time, which is a thing. But naturally, she's going through this rant. And then at one point she goes, spent much time in Guatemala, war, chaos, but they know how to love, laugh, party, live today, so do cancer patients, don't sacrifice joy. It's like, all right, it's all right, you could...
Fuck you.
It could have just,
fuck off.
And I'm like, genuinely, I've lost family members to cancer, I get it, it's something that's scary and painful, but it's like, I spent much time in Guatemala, it's like, fucking hell. You could have said, look at Guatemala. You could have just taken yourself out, but it always has to be. And that's one thing I find more common in the liberal Twitterers, is that they genuinely love to make it about them. It has to be. From that Observer thing about a letter to Donald Trump from someone who works at your son's new... I forget who owns the Observer and all that. But it's like from that to just the tweets where it's like, I'm personally scared. I was in a lift the other day and like an African American was driving it and I just leant over, I grabbed him on the shoulder and I said, you know, I'm so sorry that you are black. I mean, I'm so sorry that you have to have the treatment of being black because I like black people. Can you please sign this to say that I can say the N-word later? Like,
it was Harry Gopal. Yeah, they were driving next to Harry Gopal. Us.
Driving for Lyft.
Harry Gopal with Tyrone Smithers in the passenger seat.
But that's the thing. It's all about them. And it's weird. And I consider myself a liberal, moderate guy. I can't vote. So I guess fucking that puts my fucking opinion in the toilet. But it's just that I don't see the Republicans who were like, apart from the ones where it's like, I walked down the street and then a trans person jumped out of a window and I had to throw a Pokeball. Like, it's not quite that. But it seems more common with liberals, but it also might just be the fact that I follow a lot of them.
There's some pandering for sure. I see it too, where it's just like, it's rooted in a little bit of narcissism, you know, where it's just like 2016 needs to be arrested. Like what are you saying? What are you actually saying right now? You're not saying, you're not saying anything.
And also one thing, not sorry to talk over you there, but they're not saying it necessarily. I have this theory that all these fucking, let's reboot 2016, let's unplug it and plug it in again. I don't think that shit is about black people getting shot. I don't think it's about fucking ISIS. I don't think it's about terrorism. I don't think it's about the Second Amendment. I think these people, like, David Bowie died and Prince died. And, we used to have Bob Hope, Johnny Cash. It's that. I think it's that. If these people didn't die, I truly don't think, like, these people have no relation to of any kind, they just really like them. But, like, I think if they hadn't died, they wouldn't be saying this shit. I really mean that.
I don't disagree.
It's fucking... Go downstairs and cry. No, but that's my take on it. Sorry, Felix.
Oh, no problem. I mean, I'm having diarrhea. I'm very low in energy today. I like barely have the energy to complain. People that know me know it's like one of my favorite things.
I love complaining, and I think that it's a healthy thing. CJ, did you see anything this week that just fucking infuriated you?
No, I never get mad.
Yeah, you've never been mad, I hear, as well.
I've never been mad. You know, honestly, fuck. I mean, aside from the Republican convention thing, you know, I guess that's probably it. I read the transcript of Donald Trump's speech to Ted Cruz, or attacking Ted Cruz. And I think I got mad at that today, and that was about it, because I couldn't understand it, and it just made me think of Dan. It was like if Dan Quinn ran for office and stripped all the profanity out, because it was like basically gibberish, and I just got mad that my brain couldn't process it. But you know, no, I don't really get mad at it. I'm a very calm guy.
That makes one of us. And well, I did see Matt McGorry tweet just randomly, "Proud to be cuck."
Oh yeah, he did do that. What,
I don't know.
Does anyone know?
I don't know why
he did that.
Did he get cucked? I'd love it if like he completely misunderstood why people have been saying it, and he actually like someone slept with his girlfriend, and he was like, "Yeah, I'm proud to be cucked." Wait, what?
I think he's trying to, as misguided as it may be, I think he's trying to like somehow make that word not bad, or I don't really know what he's going for most of the time when he talks. I think I replied to him and told him I was going to suck his dick or something. I don't really understand most of what he posts, if I'm being honest. He's really into like vulnerable masculinity, I think. I don't follow him.
I don't either. He just like creeps into my feed like a fucking, like just like an earwig. Just this weird hunky earwig that I definitely would never kiss. And also he's just like Will Wheaton. He's famous for one random role that everyone's gonna forget.
I mean, Will Wheaton is more famous for like everybody hating him, yeah, and then him being like, "Hey, what if I made a board game about Star Trek? What if I spoke at a conference and I talked about my character? Hey guys, I'm coming out against Trump." I've never heard Will Wheaton talk, but this is how he sounds like when I read him.
And you've actually touched upon another thing, though. It's like these people, like Will Wheaton, Matt McGorry, people who outside of the internet have no fucking relevance, none. So they're like, "I'm standing up against Trump." There is not one fucking person who's like, "Huh, you know what? I was pro-Trump. Now Wesley Crusher, or Wesley Crusher's son, I guess, from Star Trek, is now like, he's mad at Trump, so I'm there." It's the echo chamber all over again, as we said so many times. They're just fucking talking to themselves, effectively. They're just sitting there being like, "Oh, yep, I'm going to say something that all my friends will agree to. Hell yeah. Put that one in the bank."
Yeah, no, they just found a lot of people that agree with them. Someone told me that like they knew someone who went to college with Matt McGorry, that he was a good guy, and I guess that's enough for me. But that's also enough for me to say that like I'm gonna assume based on that Will Wheaton is the opposite of that, and Will Wheaton, I don't know that he isn't a sex maniac. He could be some type of sex maniac, is what I'm saying, mainly.
Well, I mean, we've been trying to spread fake rumors a lot, and I know that Steve Jobs is gay, for example.
Big one.
He's gay. And I think that Will Wheaton's, that night when Arthur Chu decided he was going to do the most feminist thing ever and watch gay porn, I believe he went to Will Wheaton's personal theater, I hear, and they watched Orifice in the Office, Cram My Hole 12. Some of the classics, and they sat there and
they watched Harry Potter. I've been sitting on that one.
Yeah, nailed it. But that's the thing.
Nailed it, bitch.
But we're laughing at the titles, but they're real, and this happened. We want to make this very clear for our listeners.
This did happen. This absolutely happened.
100%. Well, I think now that we've just got angry and Felix definitely needs to shit a few times, that it's a good time to close off the podcast. Thank you so much for listening to The Scumbag this week. It's been a joy to have CJ on. I can imagine he'll come back.
Thank you for coming on, CJ.
Thanks for having me, guys. I had a great time.
Well, I've been Ed Zitron.
I'm Felix Biederman. I'm going to go shit.
CJ Lemmerys.
And thank you for listening to the episode 7 of The Scumbag. Cheers.
Cheers.
Cheers.